on the ends, on this ends of E.
Yeah.
Who will give the custom broker, the POA?
This guy.
Although their POA is acceptable. Even though they are not the banks.
Yes. It's kind of like the idea is this, it's a compromise. The idea is this, you don't want to get the owner involved with the Dell computer because I don't want to deal with this. Going back to my Dell example where I purchased Dell, I do not want to deal with customs formalities or the shipping formalities. All I want to do is this, push the power button and start using my PC. That's the modern expectation. So this is acceptable. And licensed customs broker, they are professionals who are presumed to know this. They presume to know what they are going into. If it's too high of a risk, they just adjust their fee accordingly. Higher the risk, higher the fee. So far we dealt with the directive. The directive is supplemented by regulations. But the regulations go to the issue of they take another angle. They take an angle of foreign owner, or here they call it a non-resident consignee. So the regulations begins. The regulation begins that the non-resident consignee has a right to make an entry. So if they have a right to make an entry, that means they are not nominal consignee. Means they have the interest in a transaction. If they have an interest in a transaction, meaning that they are the owner of the purchaser, this is a starting point. There must be this listed here, owner or purchaser of goods. It doesn't mean that I purchase from you, it doesn't mean I own. It's really the labels again, folks. It's the labels. I can be the selling agent. The selling agent fits this label. So learn to look at the labels. So let's say if it works better for you, then a selling agent can a selling agent be the importer of record? And a selling agent, let's say, is in the People's Republic of China. So we're talking about this label. A non-resident consignee sitting somewhere else, can they make an entry? Can they reach out and clear customs through in the United States? This is the main focus. And the answer is yes. Yes, they have a right to make an entry. They can do it. But with strings attached. The strings are you must have locals who are willing to take a hit if something goes wrong. And who are those locals? Well, first of all, it's a corporate surety for the bond. Notice, no individuals are allowed. Corporate surety. And this is for the bond. If you're using a carnet is another document, a shipping document, which serves as an entry document, as a bond. You must have a local guarantee, local resident guarantee association. Why is that? Because if you breach any conditions of the merchandise, it's very difficult for customs to reach you out in China, but the local surety is here, so they can take if the local corporate surety doesn't comply, doesn't pay up, then they can just take them off the circular treasury 570, and if they do that, they are out of business, at least out of the customs bond business. So that's not good for them, but at least customs have the ability to influence the transaction. Now we focus on a corporation. So imagine that selling agent is a non-resident corporation. First of all, what is non-resident corporation? Is not incorporated, meaning, remember, who gives birth to corporations? States. States are within the union, 50 of them. When I was talking about states, I didn't mention the other places. The other places within the customs territory of the United States there are two more. So one, which are not states. One is Puerto Rico. It's kind of like a nation island, which is considered to be U.S. territory, and for us it's within a customs territory. What is the one more? 50 states, Puerto Rico, and yes, may yes, District of Columbia, D.C. So can you have a corporation organized under the District of Columbia? Probably yes. I haven't checked, but probably yes. So this is customs territory of the United States. But for non-resident corporation, as far as right to make an entry, so here we are thinking about who can come in and file documents. The scope goes beyond customs territory of the United States to encompass Virgin Islands. U.S. Virgin Islands. There are two types of Virgin Islands: British Virgin Islands and U.S. Virgin Islands. If this is a U.S. Virgin Islands, like St. Thomas, I believe, is the capital of U.S. Virgin Islands, then you're good. If you have U.S. Virgin Islands government giving you the articles of accepting your articles of incorporation in your corporation U.S. of U.S. Virgin Islands, you just like Corporation of New York, you can come in and deliver the documents to clear through customs. Why? What's going on with that? Why is that? Well, because it's U.S. territory, for one thing. So government has a jurisdiction over it, U.S. government, including U.S. customs. But, so, if it's not U.S. Virgin Islands, if it's not in the 50 states of the Union, if it is not in the District of Columbia, then it is considered to be non-resident corporation. So even if it's in the U.S. territory outside of U.S. Virgin Islands, so I'm thinking of Guam. Guam is in, so Hawaii is a state. So it's within, it's a resident corporation. But Guam, not too far from Hawaii, is also U.S. territory. People who live there are U.S. nationals. But if you form a corporation in Guam, it is not considered to be a resident. So in a way, you have the same treatment for Guam, almost the same, as we shall see. There are exceptions. There are more lenient exceptions to Guam, but for this, to be able to take the documents and deliver it to customs, Guam is treated pretty much the same way as People's Republic of China company. All right. So, what to do? What do you have to do before you show up to customs as a non-resident company to clear this? Well, first of all, you must have an agent. Because you're outside of customs jurisdiction, you're outside of the reach of customs, you must have someone who represents you, typically customs broker, who can who can answer to customs. And service of process usually is associated with a lawsuit. Or service of process is usually, well, sometimes, no, there is a, if the customs would like to interview and would like to invite the company for the interview, they usually would issue something called summons. Here is service of process. So if customs wants to initiate a lawsuit, a judicial action, they need to deliver a service of process. And service of process is administered, there are very strict rules, meaning that you cannot have, even if you get the paper by email, if you don't have service of process properly executed, that means it's almost like you never knew about it. For example, let's talk about regular examples. So, in New York, let's say I'm being sued for whatever reason. Let's say I did not pay a credit card bill. And credit card company wants to sue me. So they invite me to the court. In order to invite me, they must execute what's called service of process. Meaning court documents delivered to me, court papers. So the representative from the credit card company shows up to the door, and my 7-year-old son opens up the door. They give it to the 7-year-old son. Son runs up, gives it to me. After closing the door behind the service processor, the question is, have I been served? The answer is not likely. Even though I got the documents, I need to have the documents delivered to me directly. Because the 7-year-old son is not what's called here in New York is a person of suitable age and discretion. I mean, a 7-year-old can take a paper, make a, I don't know, airplane, is like, wow. How can you blame a kid for being a kid? The same kind of idea transcends here, right? You have to have a proper person. So proper person usually is an agent. In the customs world, that agent is usually a licensed customs broker. And, of course, have a bond, and as we discussed, with a resident corporate surety. How does this play out in the customs broker exam itself? The next question makes a showing. So this is pretty easy fact pattern. So they give a bunch of statements, and they ask him to identify one statement which is not true. And not true with respect to what? Right to make an entry, okay, so we know the right to make an entry has to be given to the importer of record who is not a nominal consignee. So it can be owner, purchaser, selling agent, etc., etc., or licensed customs broker who is authorized. So you kind of have this mental note. Next, with that note in mind, we go through the list. Non-residents have the right to make an entry on merchandise entering the commerce of the United States. Is that true? Well, it can be true, right? If the non-resident has an interest in the property. But we're not told that. So here, where is my checks? Here's what I do. Generally speaking, non-resident has a right to make an entry, but we need more information. So I put check minus. Next, when an importer dies with a shipment of merchandise, wow, how horrible. They're waiting for the product and they die. That's awful. But This can happen, right? Usually, importer here would be the physical person. Companies usually are what's called perpetual, have perpetual existence. So, I mean, company doesn't just die. they can die. When you file articles, you can say this company will exist from this day to this day, and then automatically dissolve. But really here they're talking about someone who is biological being. When importer dies with the shipment of merchandise is underway, the executor, who is the executor? Another term. See, you get introduced to all those terms, which really have very few things to do with customs. But they have real life implications. Executor of the estate is when someone dies, someone takes care of whatever remains after you. Usually, let's say, if I die, not to be too superstitious. Let's say not if I die. Let's talk about if a customs broker dies. No, let's say a person dies, and that person is married. Usually, it's the state law that would decide, but usually it would be the wife or the husband of that person who would be executor of the estate. Usually. If the wife, and there is a tree, so if the wife is not available, then the next in kin, usually. Or if the person died and made a will, usually that, I think that would be called a trustee, but usually the person in a will would be administering that person's property. So in other words, here it would be an entity who steps into the shoes of the deceased poor importer and take care, wind up, let's say, his things. So in the eyes of the law, they can do that. Usually it is a state law. And if there is no one, what happens if there is like no one, the poor person is lonely, who would that be? Government, yes, probably state, but it would be the government.